about you. I just want to say, it was the night before Christmas, and all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even Red or Sunny, or little Lisa Marie. My favorite jumpsuit was hung by the chimney with care, with hopes that St. Nicholas was not going to eat all the cookies and milk, and he was going to leave some for the king. I just want to say, I'm one with the Force, and the Force is with me. So ladies and gentlemen, I want to say Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and here they are, Chuck and Jer.
How'd you get Star Wars and Elvis in the same fucking bit?
I don't know.
It's the most wonderful time
of your mom.
That it is. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Idle Effect, episode 18, but
18.
More importantly, we're 18 and we like it, but more importantly, the Christmas episode.
The holiday pre-episode, as opposed to the
holiday post-holiday show,
because we fucked it up last year.
We didn't get in time for Christmas last time, so we pretended we meant to do a post-holiday show.
It was all live.
Yeah, so. But now we're here. It's the Christmas season. It's still ahead of us. Merry Christmas. That's right. Merry Christmas to you. Happy holidays, people.
Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa.
Rockin' Ramadan. Fucking Festivus for the rest of us.
I've never heard that.
Never?
Did you just make that up?
No, I don't think fucking is in there. I think it's something else.
It should be.
But yeah.
I think it should be changed.
And in the Star Wars tradition, Happy Life Day. So.
Happy Life Day?
That's the holiday special, the Star Wars holiday special. That because it's a galaxy far, far away, they don't celebrate Christmas. I guess they don't have Jesus over there. You would think he'd be everywhere, but they have Life Day.
I was going to say, when did Star Wars get gay? But the minute you said holiday special, I knew when he got gay.
Yeah, it got gay right after the first... Yeah, so...
Okay.
Anyway, welcome in, and Merry Christmas, and here we are. I don't know if... I was going to say, where have we been? I really haven't been anywhere. I was wondering if you have.
Fuck, because I was going to pass and let you go, because I've been to Home Depot.
That's about where I've been, more or less.
And I've been to Costco, and I've been to Walmart.
Well, did anything have any bathroom adventures over there?
And like several trips to your mom's house.
Well, this time of the year...
I've been nowhere.
This time of the year, I imagine you had to stand in line over there. It's... See, I can take it and roll with it, and...
So can she.
I know!
Wow.
Jesus Christ.
That was easy.
So
what else you got, then?
Well, then,
Oh, by the way... This episode is brought to you by Dickies. They don't know that it's brought to you by Dickies, but it is.
I was going
to
say, either one day we're going to get a check in the mail.
Or sued.
Or they're going to a letter saying, stop it. So
probably that last one.
For those of you listening on iTunes and Podbean, we have these Dickies cups that we drink out of continuously throughout every show since day one.
It's true.
And if you see on YouTube, there's always, I think a couple of the thumbnails are you like in mid-drink just holding the cup right there. So
I planned those on purpose.
Of course you did. Absolutely.
I put a lot of thought into that.
You thought, well, you know,
if by a lot you mean absolutely
yeah.
Then yeah, that's what I do.
Maybe a little thought into the show would
Really?
We direct some of that energy.
What happened to, like, Happy Merry Christmas, you fucktard? I'm gonna go there already.
Well, okay. I'll
this could be the Chuck Holiday special. I can get the fuck out of Dodge if you want.
Well, I wanted to do something, since it is the holiday special, and since Mark and Brian are no longer with us.
At least not like they used to be.
Well, they're just not on the radio.
Brian didn't die, did he?
Not that I know of.
I know where Mark is, but...
Well, actually, his radio show got pulled just the other day, or not too long ago.
Got pulled or got pulled from our neck of the woods?
I think it's gone. He did an LA show from North Carolina, and they decided to go with more music. So
yeah, but less talk, more music. It's a syndicated show, and they change who they use all the time.
Oh, okay.
So chances are it's still on, just not here.
Well, maybe. It could be.
I'll bet you $5 American.
5 credits.
That's all I got.
5 bars of gold
pressed Latin.
Wrong franchise. So, but anyway, Mark and Brian, of course, our LA DJs used to be here. Probably a big influence on us, I guess you might say, maybe, more or less.
Sure.
This is something they did every year. Right around Christmas time. So to kick it off, the dropping of the Yule log. You remember this?
I do.
Probably the most exciting night of the year for children everywhere. At our house, the ritual is always the same. Mom hurries dinner out of the way so that the festivities can begin. First, I lay a fire in the fireplace.
Crackle, crackle.
I pride myself on the way I lay a fire. To begin, I crinkle newspaper to put under the grate.
Are we going to get sued for this?
By Disney, maybe, yeah, because they own it. It's from a Disney album. So.
I don't like Disney anyway.
Fuck them.
Then I put in the kindling, breaking the sticks into the proper lengths.
And what length would that be?
Then I bring in the Yule log.
Here it is. Here it comes. Great.
That's the biggest log we've ever had, Dad.
Yeah, and the heaviest, too.
Oh! So there you go. The Mark and Brian dropping of the Yule log. Yeah, don't mind. Still figuring out this high-tech equipment.
It's out of control!
So, Jesus.
You're just having all kinds of trouble. Should we stop and regroup?
Whoa, what's that there?
It's a well-oiled machine here, so, Chuck and Jer.
So the Yule log has dropped, and that's what Mark and Brian used to do every year. They're gone. I miss Christmas with Mark and Brian, and that was one of the things they played from a Disney album.
I have two questions.
I never got it myself. I never found it funny, but what the fuck, right?
You never got it?
Well, I get it. Yeah, it's
I was going to say...
I get it.
Was that a double entendre for one? And then for two, how do you spell entendre?
That's a good question.
Which one?
The second one.
Oh.
Well, if you know how to spell entendre, email us at idleeffect.yahoo.com.
That's desperate.
Now, we both have been somewhere. We both went to see Rogue One's A Star Wars Story. Although it only said Rogue One in the beginning. But I am one with the Force. The Force is with me.
And usually I get mad at you when you do this, but I'm going to go ahead and do it this time.
Okay.
Spoilers. So if you haven't seen the movie yet, then turn this shit off until you have, because...
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't want to fuck this up for you, because it was really good.
At least fast forward...
No, just turn it the fuck off.
Just turn it off.
Come back to us when you've seen Rogue One.
Right, because
it was really good, and I don't want to fuck this up for you.
Yeah. Come back after Christmas when you see it, and you'll be listening to the post-Christmas show again.
you're dead.
But we finally get to do a nice good movie review, a movie that we really apparently I'm assuming we both really liked.
You liked it?
Well, you know, it was what it was.
It was really good. With the exception of a couple of scenes that I was disappointed by, the rest of it was good.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, that we'll get to the scene. I know one of those. Now, this is set directly before New Hope, literally like I would say 15 minutes before, I mean...
Well, about 15 minutes,
this is a direct prequel, right?
In the days before, coming up to the hours before
Hope. Yeah. And it's very much like a war movie. The story is a ragtag group of rebels have to go steal the plans of the Death Star.
When you said ragtag, I was thinking Battlestar.
Really?
A ragtag fugitive fleet.
Is that
alone?
Yeah,
something like that.
So I went in basically because it's not Star Wars saga. I went in with pretty low expectations.
Or saga.
There you go. I pretty much went in with low expectations. Cool. It's a Star Wars story. It's not Episode 9, eight, which were
Standalone picture.
Yeah, but it's awesome, and it
which enables them to do a lot of things that you couldn't do in a normal Star Wars movie.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Kill everybody.
Spoilers. Now, there's no scroll in the beginning.
There's no scroll in the beginning.
Which
threw me off right out of the gate. But you know what? That's okay. I don't mind being thrown off.
Yeah.
Give me something different. And they did that.
It says, it doesn't even say a Star Wars story. It does say a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. And I remember, boom, right into the movie. And you're like, whoa, really?
Yeah.
The scroll.
There was none of that.
And then it just says Rogue One. No mention of Star Wars, but it's definitely very much a Star Wars movie. and it's got that that 70s feel, like 70s in space. I mean, it looks like
70s.
They made it look like Star Wars did in 1977, basically. I would say so.
I didn't get that.
I mean, everything looked a little more real, but I felt like the
well, clothes, it definitely had a different look. It had. I can't explain it, to be honest, but it didn't look like any other Star Wars movie. It has its own unique look.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
It didn't look like an Abrams movie. It didn't look like a Lucas movie. It looked like a totally different animal.
Yeah, yeah.
And I liked it. It was
and
good.
It opened with, it felt like the Inglourious Bastards.
Never saw it.
Never saw it? Okay, well then.
Me too, didn't do it.
In Inglourious Bastards, a German officer comes to a Frenchman's house, knowing full well. Sprechen Sie Deutsch? No, they're speaking the French. And that was basically it.
So, I sure never got you going.
No, it's kind of the same feel where what's his name?
You know, what's his name?
the guy.
The dude, that guy.
You got
from The Thing.
Yeah. Director Krennic. He arrives with those death troopers. And it's basically, and what's his name? The other guy.
That guy. The guy that always plays a bad guy finally gets to play a sort of good guy.
Mads Mikkelsen, his character.
Yeah, that guy.
He shows up and he wants to basically bring him back to building the Death Star. And he's like, oh, you know, since my wife died, everything's sucked. And oh, my condolences. And knowing full
well. Get in the car!
Basically. And, that's kind of how Inglourious Bastards opens, with a German showing up at a French guy's house.
I just told you I haven't seen Inglourious Bastards. Well, sorry,
spoilers.
You're fucking
spoilers.
It up for me.
Okay. So, now what about Saw Gerrera,
that guy.
who's the actor,
You know, you need to do more research. I count on you for this stuff, because I don't know.
The one, oh! Jin, it's you! Who's that actor?
Black guy. Forrest Whitaker.
Forrest Whitaker, yeah.
Ooh, I got one and you didn't have it.
Yeah,
I pulled it out of my ass.
He's almost sort of likened to Darth Vader. He's got the breathing, his legs are all fucked up. He's sort of the rebel side of. No? Didn't get that?
I didn't really get that vibe, yeah, but okay, sure.
Well, my favorite character in the whole thing, K2SO. Alan Tudyk.
Yeah.
The reprogrammed...
You're just struggling today.
The reprogrammed droid from the Empire, basically.
Reprogrammed droid.
He had the one-liners, and he... I think my favorite was if they said, if we hit the shield, we'll all die in the vacuum of space. Like, not me.
Not me.
I can survive in space. He basically just had no filter, and it was just kind of set... And he reminded me of Tars from... Interstellar, who was basically a droid that you could program to have a sense of humor, I think they had sense of humor on 10, and then he's like self-destruct in 9, 8. They're all then they switch the sense of humor setting on him. So,
wasn't he like a big walking box?
He's a big square box. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So we go to Jedha, which is I guess the. It's a moon that basically was the first place they practiced the Force, or it's basically the hit.
Where the temple was.
The Jedi
temple.
Yeah, we go there, and there's a guy on there. There's a character. He's an Asian guy, Chirrut Imwe. He's the one that says, "I am one with the Force, and the Force is with me."
Right.
Do you think he was Force sensitive? Did he have it? Did he have it a little?
Did he have it a lot?
Well.
Could he drive a car?
He seemed like he...
He was Asian, so chances are probably not.
Chances are... No.
But he was blind, so chances really are he probably could.
Well, it seemed like he could have had a little bit, maybe just slightly Force-sensitive.
I think he was just a full-blown effing Jedi, and you're not giving him credit, dude.
No? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I thought if anyone was going to rip out a lightsaber, I thought eventually that staff was going to become a lightsaber. It ended up being sort of a laser crossbow, but I don't know, it seemed like he sort of had a little bit, you know, he wasn't a full-on Jedi, but...
He was a Jedi wannabe?
Yeah, well, I think he was...
He was a Jed?
Yeah.
He was a Jed.
And then you got to see the the guys from that started trouble with Luke in New Hope, but then they were they were on that planet.
Yeah,
and it's like it's kind of funny because it's like in a little while these guys are going to be on Tatooine. Yeah, and I just it'd be funny if those guys just pop up everywhere in each movie, just like they're space travelers, just starting shit and going around,
just starting shit. A Star Wars story.
And then we see, I guess Jimmy Smits plays Bail Organa, is...
Senator.
Yeah. And Leia's adoptive father.
That's him.
And then we get a quick shot of C-3PO and R2-D2.
Quick shot, yeah.
So they've basically been in every Star Wars movie, I believe.
They are the common thread.
With the exception, I think, of the Ewok Adventure. But I don't know, you've seen that, I haven't.
I've not seen Ewok Adventure.
But yeah, quick little. I guess you got to do that. I mean, it wasn't necessary, but it's kind of cool, I guess.
Well, the thing is, they did a better job in this one than like in Force Awakens. And I know Force Awakens had to bring the characters back.
Yeah, you know?
So that it's a different animal. But they gave you just enough tie-ins to what you knew to make it feel like a Star Wars. I mean, just enough. Not too much, right. Not too little. Things you recognized. And then the people that played the big parts, man, they CG'd that shit to death.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Those things were dead on.
Yeah, yeah.
Tarkin, whatever his name is.
Oh, Grand Moff Tarkin, yeah, yeah.
Man, I was like, nailed
Peter
it.
Cushing is still alive? He looks pretty good. For
nailed
and
it.
And I've heard some people say, oh, it's horrible. It looks like a bad video game. It's like, what are you talking about?
No,
it's like,
oh, it looks good for what they had to do.
For what it is, yeah, I mean, yeah.
Now, Leia in the end looked a little hokey, but I thought they pulled off Tarkin pretty well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he actually got more screen time. Peter Cushing gets more screen time in death in Star Wars than in life. Although it was another actor that they put the ping pong balls on and made him look like Peter Cushing, but
fucking ping pong balls.
So, but yeah. The Leia one, I think they even... They kind of nailed the voice, too, right? I mean...
Well, couldn't they just...
I guess that's easy. I guess that's the easy voice part. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, it can't be her talking now, because she's... it would have been all like... Herp! Yeah. What's that, Leia?
It's herp! There are 40 years of smoking.
Oh, it's hope, you guys! Don't give me no back talk. So... But then on Jedha, I guess Jin sees the hologram. I'm trying to think of her last name. Jin and...
Tonic. No?
No. There's Galen is the... Mads Mikkelsen character was Galen.
It was something short. Rue, Russ, Ro, Rud.
Right.
Whatever. Does it really matter?
No, I guess not.
Okay.
Well, Jin, his daughter, sees the hologram and he explains that he's... left a weakness in the Death Star, which is kind of cool because that, for all anybody that's ever complained about, you know, why is it? Yeah, there's a hole, there's an exhaust port in the Death Star, and you just shoot in it, and it blows it up. For years, you know, and that seemed kind of weak, but now it's been explained.
Yeah, but
years
now
later,
now it spins it in another direction because if you purposely made this thing so it had a weakness, couldn't you make it have a little easier weakness than having to shoot proton torpedoes down a fucking exhaust shaft?
Just like a button on the outside, just they have to fly up and bang.
Just send a certain, just, you know, like a certain
boom.
Radio wave frequency blows it up. I mean, something a little easier than...
That's
like,
true,
I
yeah.
mean, you know.
Like a computer virus and...
I made it so you can do it, but I didn't make it fucking easy for you pussies.
Just have to shine a laser pointer on it.
Exactly,
or, yeah,
you know.
That's true, yeah. Well, I'm going to make it so you have to fly around continuously, and a lot of people are going to die hitting this weakness button. But, yeah, I guess...
If you're lucky, you might get it.
I guess you... But you couldn't make it obvious, though. You couldn't just have a big red, like... weakness here, like a Roadrunner Wile E. Coyote cartoon.
You could have made it a little easier.
Weakness here. No, I know what you mean.
I think maybe
been.
He just built it poorly and then just kind of... took it and ran with it. Well, you know what? Yeah, this one part I didn't make very well.
Well, I think back in the day, because 1977, back they didn't think of like,
no,
oh, let's
you don't think so?
Let's punch in a code and then it blows up. they needed to make it exciting too. That, I mean, what kind of fight would that be if it's, you know, that was the whole thing. Oh, here's the plans for the Death Star. Oh, and here's what we type in to make it blow up. Boom. End of story.
We've gotten totally derailed here.
So they had to go with what they, you know.
Right.
The way they actually blew up the Death Star, ultimately. So.
Gotta hate you.
Well, hey, you know. Jeez. Oh, so we get to see a couple other characters. We get to see that walrus man. He's got a name.
What is it? And don't say walrus Tusk. Man.
Mon Mothma, who is in Return of the Jedi. We see her played by another actress. But I mean, it's
which
cool.
One? Cause which one was that?
She's the one in the white gown, short hair. Kind of in the rebellion, she's sort of a high up.
Oh,
they're all sitting around the big.
Many Baltans died.
Right. Yeah.
Bring us this information. Which, when you look at it,
what does she care about the Baltans?
Well, some Baltans did die, but a whole bunch of fucking other people did too. I've heard the Baltans are the only ones who get mentioned. What kind of bullshit is that?
You know how it is. Baltans are always keeping
the Caucasian humans got their asses fucking wasted too.
This is what she's saying. Oh, and a few walrus people and squids and you know. So this is definitely a war movie, and then the fucking action and the fight scene. I know you love a good fucking space fight scene.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, man.
Starship fight?
Yeah, yeah. Damn, and there was some good shit in there.
Bring that shit on.
When they there was a crippled Star Destroyer, and then so the rebels pushed it with their just cranking up their engines, just pushing it into the other Star Destroyer, and
with the Hammerhead Corvette.
Basically, yeah, that's right. The Hammerhead Corvette. Yeah.
Damn Skippy.
And the other ones in the other Star Destroyer are like, oh, maybe we should leave, but it was too late and fucking.
I liked it.
I like it. And then Castle Vader, we got to see.
Castle Vader?
Well, that, I guess, there was kind of a castle where when you first see Vader, which is the disappointing scene, I'm assuming.
Well, there's two.
You speak of.
Yeah.
But before that, before you see Vader, he's on that planet where he actually lost all his limbs. And
I guess he
owns that planet now, maybe just to remind him, keep him angry. Like, I'm going to stay here and I'm going to remember fucking what my life could have been. But, There's like a castle, and that's from canon, basically. I think there's stories before where it's like he's got this castle.
Wait a minute. Was that on Mustafa? Was that what that was?
Moose Jaws? That hasn't come out yet.
Don't fucking do that.
Sorry.
Don't go Kevin Smith on that. It's not appropriate. No, Mustafa is where him and Kenobi fought in Revenge of the Sith, and he got his shit cut off.
Yeah, basically a big fiery ball.
Yeah, it's a big volcanic planet.
Yeah, he got it cheap.
I didn't really know. So that was where his... I didn't really know.
So
that's Mustafa.
Mustafa, yeah.
Okay,
that's
no place to call home. That place sucks.
Somebody sold him beach front property there. But he lives there. He has a castle there, and then you see him in the bath. They got him with all the... And they got the Imperial... You see the red Imperial guards guarding him. Which is pretty cool, because that's when he's most vulnerable, I guess, so... He can still use the Force, I'm sure, from the bath, but he's got no arms.
These are the things you think about.
But then he comes out...
He can still use the Force from the bath.
Yeah, yeah. He comes out and he gives the, who's he... Is he talking to... he's talking to Director Krennic at that point, right?
Yeah, the first scene that you... I mean, well, okay, the second scene, but where he actually speaks, you mean?
Yeah. And he gives him the line, "Hey, man... Don't choke on your ambitions." Gives him the Elvis claw.
That was the first part of the movie where I thought, well, that's fucking weak.
Don't be choking on your ambitions, man.
That's fucking
weak. If you're going to choke on anything, make sure it's a peanut butter and bacon sandwich, you know what I'm talking about. So that was... What's the other scene that you were disappointed in? Because I know you were disappointed in that one.
There was another scene he was in where he just... and I know James Earl Jones did the voice again.
This is CNN.
But he didn't really bring it in either one of those, and I thought, okay, this movie's gonna be all great, except for the fucking Vader parts, which sucks, but oh well. But it's still a win, but it's not a win-win.
Because James Earl just took the paycheck, or?
But when Vader boards the Rebel ship and is making his way through the corridor, fucking getting it on.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Now that makes up for all those other shitty scenes, because that was badass.
Yeah, he's clearing the hallway in that.
He was decking the fucking halls.
He's putting the panfish down. He's like cutting through about 20 guys, deflecting. He's doing that deflecting their fire thing, which is cool because you only saw that in Empire Strikes Back, on Cloud City, or when Han Solo shoots first. So yeah, you get to see him fucking, and I think he makes a guy fly up on the ceiling and then throws his hand back and cuts him in half, like kind of just behind the back, like Magic Johnson or something.
They need to like have a, when they come out with the DVD, they need to have like a special where they slow that shit down where you can watch that shit in slow motion.
Right, yeah, yeah.
The DVD. And they, because that was badass.
Yeah, yeah.
That was Vader.
Have them put it to music or something. So, get up! So that made up for the shitty fucking earlier.
For the pussy Vader.
I did want to see more Darth Vader, but of course, you know, you're just not going to get that. You know, hopefully we get more of them in the Han Solo movie or whatever.
Han Solo movie.
There's going to be a Han Solo movie. Yeah.
He's dead.
Well, this is going to be a, like this one, a prequel type of thing. It's going to be a young Han Solo.
It's confusing me.
I was going to say, somebody walking into this movie who just goes to the Star Wars movies and doesn't quite follow, and maybe the last one they saw was Force Awakens, now they're watching this and they're going, wait, what?
TNT's like, fuck, and we got to jam this movie in here between these other fucking movies, and this movie needs to get stuck on the fucking end. And we got to buy the rights to this and this and...
But I love the shot of director Krennic. He was the guy kind of in charge in the white suit that in the trailer you saw him doing this walk across the water with this cape dragging in the water. You don't see that in the movie. There's a few things you saw in the trailer you didn't see in this movie.
Like, is that true?
Yeah, like when Jin says, "We're a rebellion, right? So we rebel, or I rebel, or whatever." She never even said that line. But there were like months of reshoots after that trailer, so that might be why.
See, now you've ruined it
for
me.
But I love the shot of him because he was all about building this Death Star. That was his life's ambition. And then there's the shot of him when he looks and it's about to basically kill him. It's about to take out the whole...
Right.
Yeah. And he just looks up and he's like, oh, shit. You know, there's... There's the Death Star just staring at him. Kind
of like when Wile E. Coyote runs off the cliff and he hangs there just for that 1 second. Right, yeah, he looks down, like, holds a sign up.
A lot of Wile E. Coyote references in this movie. It's like... But there's a scene... No, it's... What's interesting is there's a scene in Star Wars A New Hope of on the Death Star when Vader and Tarkin and basically all the officers on the Death Star are meeting in a room. It's the famous scene where... Vader chokes the guy.
I find your lack of faith.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Disappointing or whatever. There's an empty chair at that table. And this takes place after director Krennic dies. But, I mean, that's... Did you think they saw that empty chair and said, we need to write a character that probably would have sat there, but he's dead?
I think you're overthinking it.
You think so? I don't know. We'll see.
Or maybe we won't.
Time will tell.
Or maybe it won't. Yeah.
But ultimately, Jin gets to see her dad, Galen, who we can't remember their last names.
Briefly, and then he dies.
Then he dies, but, you know.
But it's okay, because they all die.
But, you know, that's a little tear-jerking. Lots of planets in this movie. It's kind of like Avengers, or Captain America Civil War, but with smaller font, you know, because it's like Jeddah. The one you saw, Mustafa. I mean, end up on a tropical planet with AT-ATs.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, well, they did. Yeah. And you get to see Gold Leader and Red Leader. And do you realize that was the same footage from...
Was it?
Yeah.
I thought maybe it was, but I wasn't sure.
Yeah, those guys, for all we know, because everyone's like, good. For all we know, those guys are dead or on the streets, and they're like, hey, what the fuck, you know, where's our check? So, but you don't see Porkins, though, unfortunately. No Porkins.
Fucking Porkins.
So, they get on this planet.
High cholesterol in
I can't believe, I'm still to this day, it's like, I can't believe they character was called.
Ass in there.
Yeah, and called him Porkins.
They buttered
even
him
in
up.
A galaxy far, far away, you know, it's
pork. It's still body shaming?
It's still, referring to him as a pig. So, but yeah, on this tropical planet, which is basically where the Death Star plans are, that's where everybody goes, and the most of the team has to run interference while they go find the plans, which kind of reminded me of the ending of Winter Soldier, where it's trying to get the plans, and everyone's going around this, what looks like a one of those arcade grabber games or whatever to get the plans out of there. And my favorite character in this whole thing, K2, gets fired upon by Stormtroopers finally hit something, and it's my favorite character. But it takes like 10 of them to put him down.
Yeah, in a while.
Right, yeah. So he's the one that I'm hoping some way, because he was a droid.
He's a droid, they can fix him.
I'm hoping they can bring him back, because that was a fucking cool character. But it's a standalone
movie, they're not going to bring him back. These people were all done and they're dead.
Well, since he's a droid, his body can live forever, and maybe he'll show up in episode 8 or something. He won't. Maybe he'll show up in Saga.
Never see him again.
No.
That would mean Alan gets more work.
Yeah. Well, ultimately the plans do get uploaded, which a lot of computer shit going on, a lot of stuff that today is pretty, look, current crap.
So I got a question for you.
Yeah.
You ready?
Uh-huh.
You sure?
Yes.
If you're a TIE fighter pilot,
yeah,
and you get your ass taken out by a pilot in an X-Wing who just happens to be the Maytag repairman, you think the rest of the guys fucking laugh their ass off at you?
I'm sure they do, but you're dead.
You're dead. I guess it really wouldn't bother you.
At your funeral, the eulogy is like,
taken by the Maytag
guy.
That's fucking sad.
Well, in this case, everybody gets taken out. The whole team.
God, they do.
Everybody dies. Spoilers. And nobody gets out alive.
Nobody lives.
And the funny thing is, Felicity Jones, who played Jyn Erso, right? Jyn Erso?
Maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, sounds about
Felicity bad. Jones is signed on for another movie, though. So maybe somehow, some way, maybe she was force sensitive and she's a ghost. She's in the afterlife. Maybe she's a hologram. She gives a message to somebody. Or, who knows?
I know, but I can't tell you. Yeah.
So, who knows? Although, you said.
Yeah.
Although, there were a lot of reshoots on this, and ultimately, the original ending... Not everybody was gonna. Everybody was gonna make it out.
Well, I don't want everybody to make it out, but I wouldn't mind if one person lived
the talk. Yeah.
So you could say that guy.
Yeah.
Chick. Well, or that robot. Or that guy's cop. Something made it out.
Something's coming out.
Nothing came
Hopefully
out.
Hopefully, it's that guy's cop.
It's all dead.
But I guess the original ending. Gareth Edwards didn't think he could kill everybody. He wanted to. But he thought he had to write it so everybody made it out. And then Disney ultimately...
said, we're going to get dark on your ass, yeah, and kill them all.
Well, I guess they say, well, it only makes sense because these people aren't in A New Hope. You know, so they must... Maybe they must be dead, you know.
Because
there's no such thing as shore leave in the Rebellion, I guess.
If you're going to take out the Death Star, people got to pay.
People. That's why they call it a Death Star.
Everybody dies.
So, but... Felicity Jones signed on for another movie. Who knows? I remember even right about that. It's sort of a Terminator ending when it was taking out Jyn and Cassian. They were hugging. There was no time.
Right before the blast.
Yeah. I thought. Oh no! Here comes the kiss, and they didn't go there, which is cool. There was no reason to, for that. I don't know.
Dude.
Just see what has been kind of silly.
If I see the blast coming, I don't care if it's my sister, man. I'm getting what I can, I'm getting what I can get before I get vaporized.
I'll grab a Wookiee.
Yep.
Whatever. Come here.
Small dog.
But I remember right at that moment, I said, two to beam up. I was sitting next to you. And it took you a while to turn and say, wrong franchise, dude. I think you were a little choked up. I think you had to... Basically, you had to, reel it in.
I think you're fucking hot.
And I'm not sure, but I almost felt bad. I'm like, oh, I'm making a joke. Jer's getting emotional here because everyone's dying off. And then you're like, wrong franchise, dude.
No. I think you're mistaken by ignoring you for emotion.
Shit. So, but yeah, in the end, it ends up basically, I don't know if it's 15 minutes before A New Hope. It ends up with Princess Leia, and they give her the plans after Darth Vader clears the hallway and the plans barely make... That guy was trying, too. He wasn't handing the plans to anyone. He was trying to open the door. He's like, I'm getting out of here. Fuck this.
Yeah.
If I die, everyone's going to die. I'm like, just hand the plans to somebody. Finally, he does, and they get him to Princess Leia, and we all know what happens next, basically. But, it ends within... I guess, what, an hour before A New Hope starts or something?
Yeah, however long it takes for Vader to get in a ship and track that same ship down and
track it
in again.
Yeah. So. But fucking overall, I think this might be my favorite Star Wars movie.
Well, that's...
Is that too much?
That's a little too much.
A little
much.
Thick.
Empire is still the go-to.
It is, yeah, except I like Jedi better than Empire. Remember, we covered that.
Yeah, but remember, you're wrong.
I'm wrong, yeah. No, Empire is awesome, but I don't know, this thing was fucking badass. This is...
You know what? I don't think you can rate it with the other Star Wars movie, because it's not... It's its own...
It's a Star Wars story.
It's not part of the... Of the storyline, it's its own side. So I don't know if you can. It's kind of like apples and oranges, man. If I had to do it, then I would go Empire, and probably Revenge of the Sith, and then this.
Yeah.
And then all the rest, but
and the rest.
I think you leave it alone. I think you just judge it on its own merits and don't try to.
But definitely judge it.
Definitely go see it. It's fucking great.
So, for you, Rogue One or Force Awakens?
Rogue One. Rogue One by far. It's not close.
Not even close? Okay.
I mean, is it okay to say that Force Awakens was good, but it wasn't fucking all that?
Yeah, sure it is.
Because everybody was, oh, it's fucking the best thing.
Yeah.
It was good.
It was, yeah.
But it wasn't all that.
Right. Yeah,
and they killed Han Solo. How good could he be? Fuck you.
Fucking Abrams. Well, I think that was Harrison Ford's idea.
I know, but he could have talked him out of it. They could have thrown money at him or something.
I don't want another $80 million to make one of these movies. I just kill me off. But, anyway, fucking Gareth Edwards, director, extraordinaire. What's his next? He did, prior to this, he did Godzilla. And then...
Oh, no.
Oh, Godzilla! Little goes Tokyo! And he did a movie called Monsters, which I haven't seen. But it's basically a movie about a guy that goes to towns where there's been disasters and he's filming a documentary or something like that. And he says, he's saying monsters are attacking.
Mm.
So he's using the grace of God to be proof of monsters.
Which sounds
cool. Well, I don't get it either, but I want to see it. Okay. I need it. But whatever Gareth...
needed?
Yeah. Whatever Gareth Edwards' next thing is... I'm on board. I want to see it.
What if it's like Beaches?
Pink.
What if it's Beaches 2?
Beaches meet My Pretty Pony.
Yeah, what is that? Are you on board then?
I'm gonna grit my teeth and fucking bear just see what it's all about.
What if it's Santa Claus conquers the Martians part douche?
Santa Claus conquers them from behind. Well, then I'm fucking... You're go, totally Gareth! Yeah.
So, anyway,
fucking awesome.
Short story long, yeah, go see
story
it.
Yeah. And you know what? I will say, you probably don't know this. I was in a Star Wars short.
No, you weren't.
And if you ever check on YouTube, there's a little film from 1992 called Palm Desert Star Wars. Palm Desert being one of the cities, the city I lived in at the time, but... One of the cities in our area. So
I thought you were going to say one of the cities in America.
In America.
No shit.
It's one of the cities in America. So check that out. Palm Desert Star Wars, a 1990... Oh, and there's also a part two.
Yeah, and then if you get done with that, then go see Rogue One.
Yeah.
But definitely see the Star Wars Palm Desert
You're
going to
want to see Palm Desert first.
Otherwise you won't get Rogue One.
So...
priorities.
So you wanted to do a list.
Fuck you. What a fucking liar.
So
I tolerate your lists and your list ideas.
So getting back within the Christmas theme.
Yeah, can you guess what this list might be about? Anybody got any kind of a guess?
Festive merry... Well, yeah, I know. I mean, what are you going to go with? You do a Christmas list? What else are you going to do? Your best... top 10 Christmas songs, right?
So. Yeah, but you didn't want to go just best. You wanted to go best. You wanted to go worst. And then even right. that wasn't enough. You went list fucking crazy.
We're going to have three lists on this
show.
You are
a list whore. Just...
As always.
So let's get to it, because we'll be here all fucking night if we don't.
Okay. Well, do you want me to go first?
No, I'm going to go first. Well, I can sit there and... Oh, you want to go first because you got something planned.
No. I was going to say... I already know your favorite, right?
You're a mean one.
No.
Mr. Jer.
I've never even seen that movie.
This is just a dig at you. You're kind of the Grinch of the show.
How is that true?
How is it not?
I'm a fucking delight.
Okay.
Ask anybody on my payroll. They will tell you.
So go ahead. What's your... This is.
Are we doing best songs?
Top 10. We're doing our top 10 best. Yeah. We got the top 10, and then we're going to have the lowest 10. But we're going to do our favorites.
Lord knows the top 10 wasn't enough
right.
for this list fucking horror.
So we're doing our favorites right now.
All
right.
Well, number 10 would be... And I just kind of went... Just with what I like, and I went from all different kinds of sources, so if you don't like it, tough shit. Number 10 would be...
I'm cool with that.
Put a Little Love in Your Heart from the end of Scrooge, when they're all singing the cast at the end of Scrooge with Bill Murray and everybody.
Yeah.
Put a little love in your heart.
Hardly a Christmas song, but...
It's totally a Christmas song because it's in Scrooged. See, you're already giving me fucking sore ass, and I don't need it.
Oh, you'll be getting the sore ass. Well, I mean, you know, hey.
It's in fucking Scrooge.
I guess there aren't enough Christmas tunes out there to pull a top 10. You might have to pull...
It's in Scrooge.
Songs that might have appeared in a Christmas movie somewhere. Okay. All right. Go ahead.
All right. Then, number 9, Please Come Home for Christmas by the Eagles. And I know it sounds like a Beatles song, but I don't care. I still like it, so I feel Christmassy when it comes on.
Sure.
This one, I'll have to explain it. The song's called Christmas Time Is Here, but it's from the Charlie Brown Christmas special, and it's the music they play in the background when they're walking through the snow, and it's the kind of that solemn... Is this it? Is that it?
That's it?
Yeah! I like that! That... Yeah, see?
That's the one!
I'm 10 years old when I hear that shit.
Yeah.
I have to watch that shit every year, even if I have to rent it, because that's Christmas for me. Charlie Brown Christmas is Christmas.
I agree.
Alright, so that was, what? 8.
8. Wrap it up, kids.
Number 7 was Mr. Hanky the Christmas Pooh.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah, I knew you'd get down with that.
Mr. Hanky the Christmas Pooh. That one right there, right?
So now we're going to go back to Charlie Brown special.
Okay.
Number 6 would be Linus and Lucy, and that's...
I like that one too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Gotta have it.
Which I always considered that the Peanuts theme, but it is. It's originated in the Christmas one.
Yep.
So it's yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Yep.
Yep. Yep.
So I'm not gonna disagree and say that's not a Christmas song.
Well, that's awful damn baby. Number 5, we've already covered it in the opening of the show, Blue Christmas, Elvis. Oh. I'm not going to do it again, because you already did it.
You know what's... Can I play one thing for you real quick?
If I said no, would it make any difference?
Speaking of Blue Christmas, you may not know this, but I'm a veteran of
podcasting. I hate it when I inadvertently set you up.
I'm a veteran of podcasting. This isn't my first rodeo, although it probably doesn't show.
He said as he held up a 20-year-old cassette deck.
I found this tape from 1979... Christmas Day. This is me. I was probably about 8 years old. So this is my very first venture into the podcasting world.
Oh, wow.
So, basically, nothing's changed. I still got the same Elvis.
Man.
Same way I opened the show. Elvis impersonator was probably better, I think, back then, right?
Yeah, you had a little bit of pitch back then.
So, but yeah, here we go. That was from Charlie's Recording Fun Tape on Christmas, 1979, when I first got my tape recorder.
Charlie's Recording Fun Tape.
Yeah. My handwriting hasn't changed either. That's actually better than now. So
your titles are as good as your singing.
So there we go. A little bit of podcasting history, folks, right there.
Very little.
Show, free
extremely
of charge.
Extremely little. Number okay. four would be Father Christmas by the Kinks, because any Christmas song where people like fucking threaten Santa to beat the shit out of him if they don't right. give him stuff, I'm down. So that's cool.
As well it should be.
Number three would be 2,000 Miles by the Pretenders. I actually like that song. You know what song that is?
You're all, I actually like it. Well, it's in your top 10, I would hope.
Well, no, some of these songs are there because they're funny. Some are yeah. there because they're there, and some are there because I actually enjoy listening to the song. And 2,000 Miles by the Pretenders is a good song.
I'm not sure if I'm 100% familiar with it.
How about 50%?
I still might need you to give it a little.
I can't help you then.
I mean,
you're out of luck.
Is it?
I forget how it goes now, but I like it very much.
Okay.
When I hear it, I go, oh yeah.
Fair enough. We'll fix it in post. We'll throw it in.
Man, you know I don't fix things in post. Number two would be Baby It's Cold Outside, the Dean Martin
the
version.
The Dean Martin version, okay.
Only because it's just so date rapey, and I can just picture Dean just pushing
you can,
up
you can
on
just
some
relate.
Cooking. Yeah.
you're 15 again, where you...
Dean's just going all Bill Cosby on some poor fucking chick, and he's like,
Baby It's Cold Outside.
Baby It's Cold Outside.
Let me make you a nice eggnog and cappuccino.
For a nice little Christmas nap.
Christmas nog with some pudding for you.
And
that's nice.
Number one would be Adam Sandler's Hanukkah song.
Oh, yeah.
From Saturday Night Live.
Nice.
Yeah, you got that right.
I like that one.
My list kicked your list ass. You might as
well
put your
list
away.
You haven't heard my
list
yet.
It doesn't matter now. It's all over. All
right. Well, yours is more, I guess yours is a little more entertaining. Now.
What a shock.
Yeah. Now, number 10, we already actually touched on it just a second ago. Christmas time is here.
Okay.
I, too, am 10 years old when I hear this, and I'm taken back.
Yeah, the Charlie Brown special
yeah,
is the best.
Yeah. We actually pretty much throw this on, like, 20 times. We throw the special on. I have it on. I had it on VHS. Now I have it on DVD. Pretty much throw it on every 20 times a year. So, dig it.
Dig
Not,
it.
Dig it. number nine, Stevie Wonder, That's What Christmas Means to Me. Have you heard that one?
Nope.
Candles burning low.
Nope.
Lots of mistletoe.
Nope.
Lots of snow and ice. Maybe.
You're not doing the head bob.
Everywhere you go. Clowns. No? Okay.
Nope.
It used to be, I really started digging that song back around the early 2000s. There was a Coke commercial with this kid going around the room trying to get girls to kiss him with mistletoe. And they wouldn't do it, and this song was playing at the time. And then finally he cracks a Coke open, and like the hottest girl in the room comes over and kisses him. And
so she's a Coke whore.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, now! Woo-hoo-hoo!
God, I'm good. Sometimes I amaze myself.
Now, it's not that funny, people. All right, Smashing Pumpkins. Number eight, Smashing Pumpkins, Christmas Time. It almost sounds like the Peanuts one, where he's like, Christmas time has come. But then he changes it up. There'll be toys for everyone. You know, like he does. And there's a little pan flute solo in it. It's actually a pretty good song.
Is.
I'm not doing it much justice, but nice song. Number seven, all right.
I got your pan flute right here.
Say What You Want, Mariah Carey, All I Want for Christmas Is You.
I can say what I want. I can. Are you sure?
You don't agree?
I mean, I've never heard it, dude, so I just...
Never? Oh, okay.
No. All
right. And number six, brought along with me here. You might like this one.
Or I might not.
Coming at you from 19-something.
That narrows it down.
Actually, never mind, my thing died.
19th century.
Coming at you from... I'll just say, Kenny Loggins, Celebrate Me Home. No?
No.
That's not what? Not a Christmas song?
If it's not No One to Hold 'Em and No One to Fold 'Em, I don't know what it is.
No, you're thinking of Kenny Rogers.
Oh, that guy.
This is,
Home
Top,
for the Holidays?
This is Top Gun, dude. Is it?
Kenny Loggins?
Yeah, Kenny Loggins.
Like Loggins and Messina Loggins?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Danger Zone Loggins, like...
Right. That guy.
That guy.
Home for the holidays. There you go.
I hate it already.
Well, I don't know. I like that one.
Okay.
Now, number five.
Wait a minute. Why?
Well,
That's what I thought.
That's another one that Mark and Brian used to... They even had them on their Christmas show. That's another one they played a lot during Christmas time. I guess maybe it takes me back to that time when they were on the... You know, that was the one time I really tuned into them regularly because they were all about Christmas and, you know, so am I. And I don't know. I dig the tune. Celebrate me home. Moving on to the next one. Number five, Paul McCartney, Simply Having Wonderful Christmas Time.
Okay, at least I've heard that one.
Right. Well, who hasn't? It's been played like...
Five times.
Five times since I've been up here. So, and number four, John Lennon. Merry Christmas, the War is Over.
I'm sure I've heard that, but I don't know what it is, so...
And so this is Christmas.
Okay.
So what? Now, number three, you may not have heard, I don't know, Ramones, Merry Christmas, I Don't Want to Fight Tonight.
Yeah, actually, I have heard that.
Yeah?
Which is a stupid fucking song.
Is it?
What do you mean, is it? You have to ask me?
Merry Christmas, I don't want to fight.
It sounds like every other Ramones song ever.
Basically, yeah, and I like the Ramones, so I guess that's why.
Every song sounds the same, including the Christmas song. All
right. So, I don't know. Now, number two, this one, I don't know, have you seen Christmas with the Cranks?
I have not.
Okay, because this one opens it, and it's called The Christmas Song by the Raveonettes. All the lights are coming on
now. How I wish that. Oh yeah, the Raveonettes coming at you, doing it to you. Right here from Christmas from the Cranks, going out to Jer White. I wish that I could stay. Like it?
I don't like it or dislike it.
It's got kind of a cool little surfy guitar solo in there, which, I don't know, helps the case for me. So
I'm grinching all over it.
You totally are.
Yeah.
And number one, I got an Elvis one too, but it's Christmas time. It's the one where he's like, well, it's Christmas time, pretty baby. See the snow falling all around. That's number one.
Gotcha.
So. All
right. I'm going to do my worst.
Are we doing worst now?
I'm also going to do a list.
Are we jumping into worst?
Well, why not? We just did best.
Okay.
Why wouldn't we do worst?
All right.
You want to save that shit for later?
Save it for later.
This thing is already running super long as it is.
Let's go.
All right. Worst. Number 10. And I'm not making this shit up. I swear to you, I'm not making this shit up.
No, I believe you.
Santa Claus Has Got the AIDS. That's an actual song.
You
dude.
Know what? I do. I am.
Tiny Tim did this.
Right. Yeah.
What the fuck he was thinking? Yeah. I have no idea.
Well, I'm sure it was early 80s where he didn't realize the
Santa
epidemic
Claus
it would become.
Got the AIDS.
He wasn't talking about the diet plan, right? The old
no,
chocolate
it was not.
Diet plan.
No, it was not.
You know, because
it was the other chocolate diet plan.
Santa Claus is a big guy, and maybe he was.
Nope. What'd you just do?
Trash in the place.
Yeah, okay. So number nine is Backdoor Santa from Bon Jovi, and that's all I need to say about
that. Well, I kind of like that one.
Of course you do. Number eight would be Please Daddy Don't Get Drunk This Christmas by John Denver.
Yeah.
Have you heard that?
I've heard of it. I don't know if I've actually heard it, but I do know, I agree that it exists.
I'm not sure what's sadder, that song or the plane crash.
Yeah.
It's really close.
I think he paid for that song by
the
plane crash.
Perhaps. Number six is one near and dear to our hearts. Hooray for Santa Claus!
Oh, yeah. That's from...
From Santa Claus Conquers the
Martians. Yeah.
And I don't know why they call him Santa Claus, but they do.
Santa Claus.
Yeah. That's, we're MST guys, so that we can't...
We only... Luckily, you don't have to hear that one too much.
Yeah.
It's pretty obscure.
Number five would be Funky Funky Christmas from New Kids on the Block.
God. I haven't heard it, but I can
you
only
don't
imagine.
Need to. Yeah. You're one of the lucky ones. I don't even know where I'm at anymore. The next one would be Dominic, the Italian Christmas Donkey.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not kidding.
It's got the Christmas donkey.
Some fucking doo-wop dude made this song up.
And it got to the radio. It got airplay. It still does to this day.
It's frightening. Number four would
wrong
be
with people.
I'll Never Do It on a Christmas Tree, and that was Rodney Dangerfield.
Hey, God!
When he is in some movie playing a dog,
and
he sings this song, I'll Never Do It on a Christmas Tree. They get no respect.
Oh, did he throw that in there, too?
I don't know if he did or not, but...
Although I did like rapping Rodney.
Number three, I love this one. I think this is great. Santa Hates Poor Kids. Is that fucking awesome or
are
what?
Are these songs you wrote? Or?
No! I swear to God, I did not make this shit up. Santa Hates Poor Kids. That's fucking great. That should be my number one. Man.
Jeez.
Number two, and I'm not sure how this song is a Christmas song, but supposedly I'm told it is. Fleas on a Dog. How is that? Fleas on a Dog. Fleas on a Dog.
I think you're thinking of Feliz Navidad. That's Merry...
It's like half...
That's like...
It's like half Spanish, half English.
Yeah, that's Merry Christmas in Spanish. It's Feliz Navidad. It's not Fleas on a Dog. It's Feliz Navidad.
Oh.
So...
Okay.
So, do you like that song now?
Well, it makes more sense now than Fleas on a Dog.
Right.
I didn't know how that was a Christmas song.
Once again.
And my number one song would be basically any song that has a chipmunk in it of any kind.
Really?
Yeah.
If it's got
a chipmunk in it, I just want to smash it with a big fucking hammer.
Those are classics. I had that album.
Of course you did.
I have that album.
Let me hear yours.
Okay, well, yours is, once again, I commend you.
More entertaining.
Definitely more fun.
Yeah.
Number 10, I got Grandma Got Ran Over by a Reindeer, which is also a classic, I understand.
You know the problem is you take this shit too seriously.
Apparently I do. You went and had fun with this.
Yeah, imagine that.
I didn't know we were having fun with this. So, yeah, number 9, I'll just blow through this.
Blow through this, really.
Number 9, Kelly Clarkson, Underneath the Tree.
Mm-hmm.
Number 8, Bryan Adams, Christmas Time, something about... the reason I hate this song, because there's a line in it where he says, see the look in the children's eyes, see the way the old folks smile. That line is so off the shelf that I just hate the whole song. Mm. So that's so you know.
Okay.
Kenny Rogers with Wynonna, Mary Did You Know? Did you ever hear that one?
Mm-mm.
Mary Did. Kenny Rogers. Finally, I'm mentioning Kenny Rogers. Mm-hmm. This is the gambler guy you were talking about.
Or the chicken guy.
Oh, man, I miss Kenny Rogers roast beef. I swear, I'd like, if he would have kept those open and kept ownership of them, I would say this is my favorite Christmas song ever, but.
Well, that would be a horse lie.
Right, it would be. But, okay, number 6, Mannheim Steamrollers. Now, I know they do a lot of Christmas songs, but this one, Mannheim Steamrollers Deck the Halls. It just sounds like, I mean, nothing could be more synthesized than this.
It sounds like every 80s song I've ever
heard. It is, yeah. I'm waiting for Falco to come out. Don't turn around. So I know they have a lot of them, and they should should be 10 Mannheim Steamrollers on.
Perhaps,
but, yeah. Number 5. Not sure who does it, but Christmas Shoes. That I was just standing in line, then somebody was trying to buy a pair of shoes. Please take these Christmas shoes. I don't know. It's
okay.
Something like that.
For the people on YouTube, I want you to see on our channel, just to back up my point from earlier, this is his list. See that nice, typed, very evenly spaced, neat little list? This is how he takes his shit. This is my list. Yeah, basically. Handwritten with chicken scratchings that even a doctor would go, dude, what the fuck? Exactly. This is what you're dealing with here.
Right.
Please continue with your well-spaced and, I'm sure, perfectly spelled out list.
Well, I have spell check, so
good for you.
Waitresses, Christmas Wrapping. It's basically, it's another song that sounds like every 80s song. It's Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Number 3, Straight No Chaser, The 12 Days of Christmas. They're the a cappella band that's, you know, it, I don't know, it's very smug. It's very like, look what we can do. We can sing so well on the first day of Christmas. Then another one comes in and they're messing up on purpose. And then the only thing I like about it, at the end, they sing Toto Africa. They turn it into Toto's Africa, which that actually sounds good.
Mm.
So, but it doesn't make up for their smugness.
It'll take a lot to get me away from you.
Yeah, there you go. There's nothing more than 100 men or more could ever do.
Dude, you're way off pitch.
Whatever. Number one. Now this one. No, wait. I skipped number two. Maroon 5, Merry Christmas, The War Is Over. The John Lennon song, but done by Maroon 5. Goes without saying, right? And number one, Taylor Swift, Last Christmas. She does George Michael's, or Wham's, Last Christmas. And it's bad karaoke. It's horrible. It's the only... I love every Christmas song, really. Everyone on this list I actually can deal with. And like I'm like, yeah, I love Christmas so much. Yay. Play these songs. Mannheim Steamroller, play it again. Taylor Swift's Last Christmas, I can't stand. It's horrible. It's vile.
Well, it's a remake of a Wham song. So what chance did it possibly
have? Done by Taylor Swift, so yeah.
Yeah, it had no chance.
I don't know, so.
Things that should not be, in the words of Metallica.
I thought that was that too. Hollywood Babylon. That yeah, too. Yeah. Now, the funny thing about Christmas songs, well, you have a piano in front of you. Can you play me a little Oh Christmas Tree?
I'm not playing along with your gig.
Well, you seem to be playing very nicely. Now, Christmas songs are known as holiday songs during the season. But during the rest of the year, they're basically something else. That's how you write a Christmas song. You take another song, you put a twist on it, and then you make it a Christmas song, some holiday lyrics. Now, take this one, Oh Christmas Tree. That's what we know it as during this time of the year. But during the rest of the year, what do we know it as? Something else, right? I'll tell you. I'm just a gigolo, and everywhere I go, people know the part I'm playing. They play for every dance, selling each romance. Jer, hey, what they saying? Well, there will come a day when youth will pass away. What will they say about me? When the end comes, I know I'm just a gigolo. Life goes on without me. Take us on, Jer. Oh, go, Jer. Oh, oh.
I'm soloing, dude.
That's Mel on the bass. Got McKenna on the drums. Oh, man. Getting crazy with the cheese whiz. Laying down the panfish. So you get my point, right? For a guy that wasn't going to go along with my thing, he is going to town.
Also playing the piano.
All right, let's bring it home. Anyway, for a guy that wasn't going to go with my bit, you are a very good sport right there. So.
You're welcome.
So, you want to hear another one?
I like my version of that song better.
Oh, Christmas tree, oh, Christmas tree, why don't you fucking bite me?
There you go.
Oh, Tannenbaum, oh, Tannenbaum. That's another, that's what I love to watch during Christmas is the South Park episodes. There's always a day, I think it's tomorrow that they actually, so for you listening today, if this goes up today, on Wednesday, but the marathon's going to be Wednesday the 21st, so.
What, South Park?
Yeah.
When is there not a marathon? It's Comedy Central. Well, it's going to be. Always play South Park.
It's going to be the Christmas episode marathon. So it might be too late for you listening. I don't know.
It probably is.
Maybe Jer will stay up all night and get this up for you.
Maybe he won't.
So I think.
Let's do some trailers.
We got another list for you a little bit later, but we'll do a little trailer talk.
Yeah.
So we saw a few trailers right before. Well, we saw one. Right before Rogue One. We got to...
It sounds just like that, too.
We got to see the Spider-Man Homecoming trailer, which looked pretty cool.
Yeah, it did.
I thought Michael Keaton looks good as the Vulture. He's not your not your granddad's Vulture. It's
kind of seemed like an on-the-nose sort of a choice.
Yeah.
After Birdman.
After Birdman, yeah. Okay, yeah, whatever. Informally. But it's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. And he's not like in the comics, the Vulture's like a crotchety old man in a feathery suit. And they're not going that route because I'm thinking one punch and from Spider-Man and he's done. So this is like a full-on technical, you know, flying monster, which I think he takes the... I think he gets Chitauri tech from the Avengers, the original Avengers movie. I think he gets a hold of some Chitauri tech and that's how he makes this suit. So
say that 5 times fast.
Chitauri tech?
Yeah.
Easy.
Go ahead.
I need to waste my time.
Coward.
And then we see the web wings.
Yeah.
From the comics.
Yep.
So
yep.
It's kind of cool. Maybe he's going to, I don't know, maybe for gliding or something.
I'll bet you $20 that all the scenes that Robert Downey Jr. is in are in the trailers.
Really?
I bet you don't see anything else in the movie besides what you see on the trailer.
Well, you get a cool shot of them together.
Flying by.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's going to be, you think that's just the ending? That's probably like the ending. Like, let's go get them!
Something.
That was...
yeah. You probably got all, if not all, damn near all the Robert Downey you're going to get.
Really?
In the trailers. Probably.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he gets the, we didn't see, there was a teaser before this trailer came out where Favreau was like, what are you doing? Why aren't you wearing the suit? And he's like, I'm in the suit. And he's all, look in the crate. So we're going to get another, I guess we're getting another upgrade.
I didn't see that.
It was a teaser that came out before this trailer. It was just online. And so I guess he's getting an even more upgraded suit. But I guess, I mean, you see the web wings, so you kind of know that. So, but Favreau coming back as Happy Hogan. How about that? Huh? Maybe we'll get Vince Vaughn in this too. Vegas, baby! Spider-Man! So, I don't know. What'd you think? You excited before it?
But for Spider-Man?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it'll be good.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about Blade Runner 2049?
You know, I have an issue with that trailer.
Replicants can be a benefit or a hazard. If they're a benefit, it's not my problem.
The problem with that trailer is it gives you absolutely nothing.
Well, it tells you that a Blade Runner movie's coming out.
Yeah, a fucking printed sign
and
to do that.
And Harrison Ford and Ryan Gosling will be in it.
Yeah, so I get to watch Ryan Gosling walk up the steps of this house, open the door, and Harrison Ford is in there, and that's all I get.
Yeah.
Well, fuck you very little, thank you very much.
You wanted to see if Sean Young...
No, I just wanted to see anything that resembled...
Blade Runner.
You know.
Well, you kind of get a shot of the city. It's not just a wasteland like Mad Max, right? You still get a city. There's still like, it looks like Tokyo.
Do better.
Now, do you think they will use Sean Young in this? Do you think she'll appear? Or do you think there's...
Is she still alive?
She's alive, but she's...
Crazy?
She's crazy, yeah. She's maybe a little leathery. From all the drinking, I don't know.
I wasn't sure where you were going with that.
But I'm kind of wondering. I'm thinking, I don't know, do the replicants, it's real flesh, right? So do they actually still grow old?
Dude, you know, it's been so long since I've seen that movie. I remember very little. I remember that I liked it, but I remember very little of that movie.
Why don't we put it on right now?
I remember Rutger Hauer being in it.
Yeah.
And that's all I got.
Rutger Hauer. Whatever happened to that guy?
He was good in like just about everything. Even in The Hitcher, he was
fucking... Yeah. Oh, fuck yeah.
Evil-looking little douche in the... Oh, man, he was good.
Hitcher was cool.
Yeah, it was a good movie.
Hitcher's cool, man.
Yeah.
So, well, let's put Blade Runner on right now, and we'll do a commentary on it.
No, man, I'm a little bad.
So, I think... I wish Ryan... When I see Ryan Gosling, I wish that they had made him the Flash for the movies, for the DC Universe movies. Because he looks like the real Barry Allen.
Well, push in one hand, crap in the other.
Right now?
Not right now, okay. But later, try it.
Speaking of trailers, how about those Power Rangers?
You know what? That trailer pissed me off even more.
Because you were starting to like
it. I was getting excited, like, what the fuck is this? This is cool. What is... Oh, fuck me, it's Power Rangers.
I remember you're
God
like, you're
damn
like,
it.
Is this a remake of The Breakfast Club? And then I'm like, it seems more like... the movie where the kids get the power... Chronicle.
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, this is cool. This looks awesome. And then all of a sudden, there's Rita Repulsa. Hello, Rangers! And you're like, what the fuck?
I did. It was audibly out loud.
Yeah, yeah.
What the fuck? When I was like, son of a bitch, they got me.
And I knew a Power Rangers movie was coming. I didn't even think this was going to be it. I thought it was going to be something
I was mildly
cool.
interested.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I was like, oh, you fucking jerks.
The only thing cool about that for me is when I had to babysit my cousins, Kyle and Melissa, when they were kids. Hi, Kyle and Melissa. We watched the Power Rangers every day, so I can see myself going with them and seeing it just for old time's sake.
You know you stuck Power Rangers up your ass in the bathtub. You know you did.
In fact...
You know you had the Yellow Ranger crammed way up in there.
Oh, not the yellow. Oh, it was the green. It was Tommy. So, I just hope they have... There was a villain called the Pine Octopus. And it was basically a pine...
Why are we still talking about
this? It was a pineapple and an octopus, like, hybrid.
Pineapple and an octopus.
Yeah, and the Power Rangers. That was one of their... They had to fight
Which
the Pine Octopus.
Which just justifies even more, while I hate the fucking Power Rangers. Are you fucking kidding
so,
me?
No, I'm serious as a heart attack. So...
Moving on.
Any other trailers you saw that you
want? Well, another trailer that I was disappointed by was the War for the Planet of the Apes. Because I'm a big Planet of the Apes, the last two anyway.
Right, yeah.
I liked the last two, especially the first one of the new reboot. Man, that's good.
Well, the first one is actually the one with Wahlberg, right?
No, that one don't count.
It does. Isn't it in the same universe and that's the
no,
future?
No. That's a standalone... No, when they rebooted it again...
Yeah.
With... you know, what's his face?
Franco?
Yeah, yeah, with Franco. Uh-huh. That was the first of the once again rebooted Planet of the Apes.
Are you sure that
I'm positive.
Wahlberg's thing isn't the far future?
No, that is not part of it.
It would make sense.
It's not part of it, and stop it.
Okay.
So anyways, that being said, I like those last two were good.
Yeah.
But this, and there's nothing that says that this one won't be.
Yeah, it's just a trailer.
The trailer gives you, once again, nothing. Yeah, okay, it's apes and humans and they're not getting along. Okay, thanks.
We knew that.
Fucking knew that.
We kind of figured.
And it's got Woody Harrelson in it. Okay, right, cool, yeah. Great, whatever. Other than
adds
that,
a little extra element of crazy.
You know, come on, give me a little more than that.
Well, you want the whole story or the whole plot right out there? You want them to unzip it and just... Here you go, Jer. Here's the full fucking...
You know what Woody Harrelson was good in and nobody
Cheers.
Ever talks about him? Hey. Actually, he wasn't that good in Cheers.
No.
Rain of Fire, I think it was what it was called? The Dragon movie? Christian Bale and him and...
Never saw it.
Where dragons like take over the earth.
I'm aware of it, but never
it's
saw it.
It's actually a really good
was
movie.
It good?
Yeah, it was a good movie.
Okay.
He was a prick in that.
I'll check it out. I liked him in Zombieland.
Never saw Zombieland.
No? Yeah. He was good. He was a prick in that.
Reoccurring. <Yeah. laughs> And of course, Passengers comes out, well, for us tomorrow. By the time you hear this, probably
right.
Yesterday.
You've seen it and it's gone to video. So.
And Assassin's Creed comes out
tomorrow.
The board over there said Ass Creed.
Creed.
Yep. Yeah, I abbreviated Ass Creed. And if it goes the way as all freaking game movies, it'll suck freaking But maybe we'll get lucky.
Maybe, who knows? It's got Fassbender.
All game movies always suck, man. Every time.
Well, the Kubrick cartoon was pretty good back in the day, so I there's hope yet. So, hey now.
You're pinning your hopes on that, huh?
I'm pinning my hopes on nothing.
Well, pin your hopes on some news.
Okay.
Because we got to get this thing wrapping up here.
We will.
My God.
Fucking wrap this pig
like
soon.
3-hour show. My Lord.
Okay. Let's get into the news.
That's a pinball machine, you fucked hard.
Exactly. I hope you'd catch up on that. Well, guess what? Indiana community lifts 60-year-old ban on pinball.
What?
Yeah,
some fucking hick community banned pinball machines.
Welcome to the 90s. It's surrounded by city officials at a local record shop last week. Kokomo Mayor Greg Goodnight, Kokomo, on the Florida Keys. He signed an ordinance resting on pinball machine lifting the city's ban on the game. The Kokomo Tribune reported the mayor said he and city officials are pleased to bring pinball back to its popular stature here in Kokomo. So apparently, it was really big in the, I don't know, 40s, and then they said no more, I guess. So he invited Police Chief Rob Baker to play the first legal game of pinball in the city since 1955. So.
Fucking whatever.
It's like one of those laws they make and everyone forgets they made it.
Living in the Stone Age.
So.
Did Kevin Bacon come to their town and tell them it was okay to dance, too? Fuck.
Was that Kevin Bacon or was that Patrick Swayze? I'm thinking of the other movie.
Swayze was Dirty Dancing.
Dirty Dancing, okay, yeah.
Nobody puts fucking baby in the corner.
Okay,
so... I never even saw that movie. I don't know how I know that line, but whatever.
I saw it. Not bad. Yeah, is what it is.
feel like dancing.
Want to fancy night away. Actually, I watched that movie with Natalie, and she said, I love these songs. Patrick Swayze sings these songs. I'm like, no, he doesn't. Come on, he's not singing it because he's dancing to him.
Let her think what she wants.
This is not Patrick Swayze. Well, guess what? I was serious radio.
Ha, he did sing.
Guess what comes on? Patrick Swayze and then the name of the song, and I'm like, oh shit, and it's from Dirty Dancing.
Damn,
so,
right.
I know what you're saying. Yeah. So, but we'll get into some real Christmas news here because it involves a deer. I guess those deer, they have to work out for the big long haul on Christmas Eve, right? Deer burst through window of South Carolina Gold's Gym. That's right, a deer looking for some exercise interrupted patrons at a South Carolina gym by bursting through a large glass window. Gold's Gym Anderson SC shared a video of the bewildered deer as it shattered the window in the gym's entryway. He thought we said a buck could join it, and it's a...
Well, you fucked that line up.
Well, it's a stupid line anyway.
It is a stupid line, but I want you to do it anyway. Go ahead.
He thought we said a buck could join, but it's a buck to join, the gym said. General manager Brad Smith told WYFF the deer crashed through the window just before 1 p.m. on Thursday and stumbled over a treadmill and into the bar area.
Yes. Nothing worse than deer on PEDs.
Right. Smith said the deer was in the gym for about 2 minutes, and he and his son attempted to corral it and guide it back out the door, but ultimately, it left through the window it entered from. I don't know.
But the deer was okay.
I think I got some footage of the... Any minute now? Oh, there he goes. So, anyway. A little bit more news. Yeah, now at Christmas time, of course, we need extra money for shopping, right, Jer?
No, I have credit cards.
Well, sometimes you don't want to bury yourself in debt. So,
yeah, you do.
So a couple guys had a plan, but it kind of backfired. Now, Kentucky men pocket dial 911, allegedly discussing plot to rob barbecue joints. So. Two Kentucky men were arrested on Saturday after they accidentally called 911, tipping off authorities to their alleged plan to rob a barbecue restaurant where the local police chief happened to be dining. Robert Bourne and David Gringsby were sitting in their car outside of Brothers Barbecue in Danville, where the emergency function on one of their phones inadvertently connected with a 911 dispatcher. The dispatcher listened in to the call and heard the men allegedly discussing the places they might rob, including Brothers Barbecue. Authorities demanded determine where the call originated and contacted Danville Police Chief Tony Gray, who, as it turned out, was enjoying a meal inside the mentioned restaurant. So,
that wouldn't be the same town where they outlawed pinball, would it?
No, that was Kokomo. Oh,
okay.
So these guys didn't get their extra Christmas money, but what can you do?
Be smarter than that. I don't know.
I remember when those Nextel phones first came out, or my first smartphone, you could dial 911 really, really easily. It just dialed itself, and one time I saw it doing it, and my phone just accidentally dialed you, and they're all, oh, no problem, it happens all the time. Next time I did it, the lady was not so cordial. It was same thing happened. I'm like, sorry, my Nextel. And she's like, you got to be more careful. This is an emergency line. It's like, it's not my fault, bitch. And if you're listening out there, I hope you're not work. I hope you lost that job.
It's not my fault, bitch.
It's Nextel, and they're not in business anymore, so. All right. So.
So let's get to this other list.
You wanted to do another list. So this is a very predictable. I mean, Christmas time, we're gonna do a list. Why not do our top 10 favorite Christmas movies, right?
Okay, you go.
Because yours is going to be more entertaining, right?
Yeah, let's save the entertaining for last.
Okay. All right, well, number 10, I'm going to go with a Very Harold and Kumar Christmas.
See, I knew you were going to put that on your list, so I didn't
How'd
even...
you know?
Because you're predictable.
Well, I love all the Harold and Kumars.
Yes, you do.
White Castle being my favorite, but I really dug this one. This would be my second favorite Harold and Kumar movie. And my 10th favorite Christmas movie. Now, number 9, a little more obscure than most Muppet Christmas movies, but the best one by far. Muppet Family Christmas. Ever seen that?
No.
Where they all go out to Fozzie's mom's house, and she's leaving to, like, Boca Raton for vacation. So they all spend it in this little cabin, and then I think the Sesame Street people show up, and the Fraggles are there. It's all a big Jim Henson, big, you know.
Just a bunch of people walk.
Big Jim Henson stew.
Burning around a stage underneath with their hands stuck up.
Yeah,
the
a lot of fucking, you know, a lot of confusion down, yeah, hands up asses. Jim Henson actually even makes a cameo, and at the end he's washing the dishes for all the Muppets. So cool little, I don't know, cool.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Yeah. Number 8. I don't know if you've seen this, but yeah, I think you might like it. All Is Bright with Paul Rudd and Paul Giamatti.
I haven't seen it, but I'm intrigued.
Yeah. But they I think they're like Paul Giamatti's kind of an ex-con. He just gets paroled. And he goes to his friend Paul Rudd, who sells Christmas trees in the city every year, and they go open a tree lot. So they're basically the everything that's happening right there at the tree lot in New York City. So, cool story. I mean, I can't, you know, I'm not doing it justice, but...
You had me, but you lost me.
Yeah. Paul Giamatti, Paul Rudd, Christmas movie. Number 6, Polar Express.
Never seen it, but... The other day I went to the theater to see that Christmas office party movie or whatever because I just wanted to stare at Jennifer Aniston for an hour and a half.
How was the movie?
It was all right.
Yeah?
You know, Bateman. You know, your usual...
Right, right, yeah.
Your usual fare.
And
it was okay.
And JT, the kind of obnoxious funny guy.
Yeah, from Deadpool.
Mm-hmm.
But when I came out, I heard this fucking booming and banging coming from this theater. So I walk in to see what it was, and it was Polar Express in like the XD, you know... high digital whatever theater.
I thought I saw you peeking in.
Anyway.
Thanks for the invite to Office Party, by the way.
Yeah, fuck you. But I've never seen it. But it was just blasting away.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's
yeah.
Tom Hanks,
it's,
right?
Or... It's, yeah, Tom Hanks plays the conductor. Yeah. So, yeah, they put his likeness in it. And It is...
But it is.
No, it's better than that. But it's... If you're... you can get nervous. If you have anxiety, it can make you nervous because it's a lot of rumbling, fucking trains flying everywhere. It's like a Trans-Siberian Orchestra concert or Mannheim Steamroller or something. But it's well done, very well done.
Mm.
So I'd say check it out
next
time. Mm-hmm. Now, number 5, you either love it or you hate it. Love Actually. Have you seen that?
Maybe.
Big ensemble cast. Liam Neeson.
Yeah, I think I did see it a long time ago.
Like 10 stories that are kind of intertwined.
Yeah, maybe.
But not really.
Yeah.
There's kind of flashbacks. It kind of moves back
I said, yeah.
Forward. That's what it's about. So, that one. Really good, I think. Number 4, A Christmas Carol. Now, which version, you ask?
I didn't ask.
1951, Alistair Sim. The what they call the single enduring version, and I would have to agree. So Christmas Carol is like an awesome story, any way you slice it. But this is probably the best one. The one you should go out now, tonight, and find.
Well, if this fucking list ever ends, and this episode ever ends, maybe I will.
But with your magic box, I know where you can find it. You just write down in there in your little fucking living room. So, number 3, A Christmas Story.
Can I have that one on my
list? Okay, you'll shoot your eye out. You actually like a classic. I'm surprised.
Any movie that's got a kid licking a pole, I'm all I'm down.
Yeah. Of course.
Ooh. I just think about it.
Number 2, this one...
Smack my ass.
Number 2, It's a Wonderful Life. Murray! Have you seen it?
No,
you're still... Yeah, you're still... Right, yeah. But of course. Okay. Ready to go to number two?
I'm ready to go to number two.
Right on someone's chest. Yeah. Bringing it.
Ugh.
Bringing the lumber. Okay. Now that we've lost everyone. Now, for those of you who have stayed with us, this rest of this list is just for you. Number two, It's a Wonderful Life.
Never saw it.
You haven't seen that? Mm-mm. All your life?
Yeah, all my life. No, there were parts of my life where I didn't see it, but there were other parts where I saw it a ton. No, dude. All my life, I have not seen it.
Well, I would say at this point...
It's too late.
Yeah. Don't fucking bother. You have to watch it at a certain point in your life, or... Yeah, it's but you know, of course, you know, a million and a trillion It's a Wonderful Life fans can't be wrong, right?
Yeah, but that movie, you know, they probably play it, you know, one time a year on TNT, but a Christmas Story, they put that 24 hours straight.
Yeah, right, yeah, that's 24 true.
24
yeah.
hours of
yeah.
a kid licking pole.
Yeah, that's, well, as far as I know, Jimmy Stewart, as a young child, doesn't lick the pole in this, so...
Well, maybe he should. Maybe I would have watched.
They ever remake it, so... Now, number one, National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Yeah, I get that one
too. Christmas time is here! I mean, what can you say? It's, you know...
It is.
That one I can watch over and over.
And probably have.
And you see, I'm going home to watch it tonight. So. All right.
Eventually.
So,
all right. Number 10.
Mm-hmm.
Reindeer Games. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
I couldn't help it. It's too easy. And some of these people are, it's not a Christmas movie. Yeah, well, suck it. It is. Gremlins, number 10.
It can. Yeah,
it's a Christmas movie. Deal with it.
Yeah. My new dog looks like a gremlin, by the way.
Yeah, it kind of does.
You seen it?
A little deaf gremlin. But it's cool because you can call him that and he'd be like, hmm?
Yeah, huh? You, like, you can call him whatever you want. Right. Yeah, yeah.
Don't call that dog lightsaber. Call him Shithead. What movie is that from?
Chud?
No.
The Goonies?
The Jerk.
Are you sure?
Yeah, Steve Martin, The Jerk.
Okay.
When they, when the alarm goes off in the building and fire, fire, fire.
That's not a Christmas movie, though.
I'm not talking about...
Okay.
God, I hate you.
So pizza in a cup.
My number nine would have been Christmas Story, but we've covered that. My eight, it was... And I know this is not a movie.
It'd still
movie,
be your number
but
nine.
But it's still... It, even though it's not a movie, it still makes my list because I fucking say so.
Okay.
Charlie Brown Christmas. It's a short, so fucking deal with it.
It's a great thing to watch at Christmas.
Damn, Skippy. Yeah. Number seven, and not to be confused with Bad Santa 2.
Which forever you'll have nightmares about, just because...
The original Bad Santa
uh-huh.
makes my list.
That's a good movie. That's funny, movie. Yeah.
Six would be Lethal
not
Weapon.
Not enough felching in that one, though.
Six would be Lethal Weapon, which, once again, it's a fucking Christmas movie. Deal with it.
Absolutely,
they actually
yes.
have a fight in, they, a, Christmas
in a Christmas tree,
tree yard.
Lot. Yeah.
Deal with it.
You know, it would be cool if Paul Rudd and Paul Giamatti were the proprietors of that lot.
No, this one here, I'm surprised this didn't make your list, because this is right up your alley.
Uh-huh.
The Night Before, number five.
You know what? It was right there. I was going to have... But I had to choose between Harold and Kumar and Night Before.
I think you chose poorly.
Because they're both a quest.
Night Before is...
They're both a quest that take place the night before Christmas,
you're
basically.
You're buying freaking weed off of General Zod, dude.
And you're the Green Hornet, Robin, and
damn,
the Falcon.
It don't
yeah.
get any better than that.
It was there. I just...
I'm going to give you a moment to change your list.
I had to go with Kumar and Harold and Kumar. I'm a Harold and Kumar guy.
Number four would be Trading Places. How do you not have Trading Places on your... It's a Christmas movie.
It is, but you... Yeah,
it's
yeah.
a Christmas movie, dude.
It is.
Don't try and fight me. Three is Christmas Vacation, so that made it three for me. Two would be Die Hard, and then you can say it again. It's a Christmas movie.
It's very much a Christmas movie.
And my favorite Christmas movie is Scrooge. Bill
Murray. Yes. Which almost made my list.
My list is so much better than yours.
But I had A Christmas Carol on there, and I figured one Christmas Carol story per list. But you know what? Upon further review of my list...
Mine's right and yours is wrong.
I actually did have Night Before. I skipped over it.
Too late.
Look, all is bright. Number 7, Night Before. Number 6, Polar Express. So if you're at home wondering, what about number 7? It was Night Before. So
if you're home wondering, what about number 7? Get a fucking life.
If you're at home, you're like, when's this thing gonna end? Fucking shut up!
That'd be a little more
fucking
realistic.
Fucking suck
anyway.
A dick!
Do you guys have fucking jobs or families to go home to, or maybe people that want us to go to sleep?
So, no, we don't. Not at all.
We do, and they're probably really pissed off.
So here we go. We're gonna jump into some geek announcements, and we're gonna fucking wrap this pig.
God, I hope so.
Wrap it for the year.
Going way long for the year. That's right.
Yeah.
After this, we deserve to break it for the year.
So in the geek announcements, I don't know why, but Suicide Squad's sequel being developed alongside a Deadshot solo movie.
I don't know why either. Either one of those things. Why would you want either one of those things?
The Deadshot movie, I'm thinking maybe DC is thinking, well, look at Deadpool. That's kind of the same thing. We should do that. You know, I don't know.
And using that same exact voice, too.
Yeah, man. We're going to... That's the CEO. That's the CEO of fucking Warner Brothers. We should do that, man. Look at Deadpool. Well, and okay, the weird thing is, because it's following the news that David Ayer will direct Margot Robbie in Gotham City Sirens, which is the Harley Quinn movie. So, but the Hollywood Reporter reveals that Warner Brothers is still developing a Suicide Squad sequel, and the trade adds that the studio is also developing a Deadshot spinoff starring Will Smith. I don't know. I think they should work on their hero universe and not their villain universe.
Anti-hero universe?
I guess. Whatever. So,
although, of those movies, I think the one that has the best shot at not sucking complete total cock would be Deadshot. Because Will Smith can pull that shit off.
Yeah, he could.
I mean, he did Hitch.
Yeah.
And that movie worked. Yeah. He can do that. Surely, God, DC could not fuck it up so horribly that it's not at least worth watching.
Right. Yeah.
The other two, the rest of them, I don't care. Whatever.
Yeah. Why, a Suicide Squad sequel, I don't
care. I don't care.
Other than the fact that, I guess it made enough money, so the studios...
Other than the fact? That's the only fact.
That's the only thing.
It made money.
So... But
and see, that's where it gets dicey, because we preach on this show, you know, don't fucking be so hard on these movies, because if you do, they won't make
they
it
won't
anymore.
Make it more.
But God, it's hard not to.
Having
be
when, said that,
it's that fine line where you don't bash them too hard because they'll stop doing it. Yeah. But try it a little harder.
Right. Yeah.
So I don't know.
Plus, DC's movie universe, they're still getting off the ground, and they're doing all these. I mean, they're planning all these villain movies. It's like, I know they have their slate set for the next few years, but they're changing that. The Batman movie, the solo Batman, Ben Affleck, who was originally in no hurry to make it.
Because he's doing Reindeer Games too.
I guess, yeah. His quote was,
I'm Batman.
No, but it's, I'm from Boston. I'm from Boston. If I could, there's nothing I'd love more than to direct a standalone, iconic, great Batman movie. But it's been done. I really want to make sure if we do it, we get the great version and one that's worthy of tradition of guys like Tim Burton, Chris Nolan, and Christian Bale.
Or at least
notice
Chris
he didn't
Nolan
say,
and Christian Bale. Yeah. Tim Burton fucking can suck it.
If you notice, he didn't say anything about Schumacher. But... Warner Brothers basically must have forced his hand, because Zack Snyder will still direct Justice League 2, but it's been delayed to make room for the Batman. So taking the slot in 2018 of Justice League 2 is the Batman. So now Ben Affleck now indicates he'll be ready to shoot his solo Batman movie in the spring, coming up. We're on the right track with that, and everything is coming together. We're still finishing up a script. I'm very excited, so... Basically, now he's rushing. So his whole, like, oh, wait, we're going to take our time. Now he's like, I'm excited. We're going to do it in the spring. We're still finishing the script.
As long as they stay Frank Miller-esque,
they'll be all right. Just have some fucking killer fight scenes, like,
And keep killing people.
Yeah. We want Batman the serial killer. Yeah. Hey. Fuck that usual code that he goes by in the comics.
No.
You know.
No. Fucking kill people. Left and right.
So.
Wasn't Batman Forever? Wasn't that a Christmas movie?
The second one?
Batman Forever?
Yes. The Tim Burton, the second Tim Burton one, right?
I guess.
Keaton? Yeah, that was a Christmas one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It had that din 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 da-da-da-da-da, Nutcracker. It had that throughout the whole movie, so...
I got more than I bargained for there.
And there was snow, and I think you caught a glimpse of the tree. Like, what would be Rockefeller Center for Gotham City, I think you saw that. So, very much a Christmas movie, all across the board.
God.
Din, 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 bang, 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 uh-uh-uh-uh-uh. Chicka-chicka-town.
Let's see, the other direction you could have went with that?
Yeah.
Instead of that, would have been, yes, it was.
Or I could have just went full on.
I like that you were amused by yourself, or either that, or...
I tell you what, I cracked myself up.
Apparently.
Me in the 70s? Fucking A. All right, we'll get into some Christmas geek announcements, and then we're out of here. We're on that sleigh ride. Now, Benedict Cumberbatch. Benedict Cumberbatch is How the Grinch Stole Christmas, Will Stew in Discontent for an Extra Winter. Universal announced the movie remake. The movie remake, based on the Dr. Seuss's children's book, has been pushed from November 10th, 2017 to November 9th, 2018. So,
translation, we're really not sure we want to make this movie.
Right, yeah. Well, it still seems like Jim Carrey's version is current. Like,
it's the fucking Grinch. Current has nothing to do with it.
But it does seem kind of odd for a... I guess, I mean, who knows? I don't know. They reboot Spider-Man every other year, so I guess that's fine.
Yes.
When did Carrie's come out?
I don't know, dude. I never saw it.
2000. Ha! I knew it. So, you never saw that one?
Mm-mm.
Oh, okay. Well,
but let's sit here and discuss that fact for a while and drag this thing out further.
Now, Avatar 2 is scheduled for a release in Christmas 2018.
Yeah, that has been a long time coming.
Yeah, I've never seen Avatar 1, so I better check that out.
You fucking lie.
I haven't.
You've never seen the original Avatar.
I saw the South Park episode Dances with Smurfs. Isn't that basically the same thing?
My God, dude, really?
I haven't seen Avatar. Is it good?
Yeah, it's good.
I should check it out.
And I'm not usually a James Cameron, you know, supporter for like... I mean,
I'm usually against him.
Yeah, I usually just hate him. No. I mean, you know.
I don't like his grandma. I just don't like anything he does.
I mean, he's done some good shit. But a lot of people are just like, it doesn't... He's kind of like Abrams. No matter what James Cameron puts out, it's just fucking... He shits gold nuggets.
Right, right.
And I'm not that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
But that Avatar is...
Blue nuggets. Well, then...
you need to see that, dude.
I'm going to see it before Christmas 2018. That way I know what's going on when I see number two, so...
Good movie.
But, and the last bit of Christmas news. Yeah, yeah, Hanson announces Christmas album for 2017. So next year we're going to have a Hanson Christmas album to add to our list.
So the last show of the year, and this is what you want to leave the people with.
Well, no.
Is a chunk of news about Hanson.
I didn't know you're going out. I didn't know where the geek announcements were gonna fall.
You wrote the fucking thing. It's on the paper. You even chose the order. You could at least led with that.
Did I mention
and finished with the Batman shit and been much better?
Did I mention that Suicide Squad is getting a sequel? So, everybody, I want to thank you, and so does Jer.
Maybe.
Thank you very much for joining us this last year. I want to say Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. When we see you again, it's going to be 2017. And it's going to be... You know what show that's going to be? That's going to be our first anniversary show. If we make it.
What did you pick this for?
Well, this is sort of a Christmassy into New Year's. And it's sad and solemn, and I want everybody...
sad and solemn?
Yeah, I want to bring everybody to tears at this point. So,
good luck with that. I'm going to be over here while you try and do that.
You can catch us on Podbean, iTunes, YouTube, and Facebook. Thank you very much. We're the Idle Effect. That's Jerry White. I'm Charles Chuck Ellis. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year, and is this better for you, Jer?
At this point, it doesn't matter anymore.
We'll see you next year for our first anniversary of the Idle Effect. Merry Christmas. Good night, everybody.
Be safe.